This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The U.S. Labor Party USLP was a political party formed in 1973 by the National Caucus of Labor Committees NCLC. It served as a vehicle for Lyndon LaRouche to run for President of the United States in 1976, but it also sponsored many candidates for local offices and congressional and Senate seats between 1972 and 1979. After that, the political arm of the NCLC was the National Democratic Policy Committee. The party was the subject of a number of controversies and lawsuits during its short existence. Contents: 1. Party objectives and ideology. 2. History. 2. 1972-1976-2. Presidential campaign. 2. 3. 1977-1982-2. 4. Right-wing contacts. 3. Criticism. 4. National Democratic Policy Committee. 5. USLP candidates. 51. NDPC candidates and personnel. 6. See also. 7. References. Party objectives and ideology. At first, the party was leftist, preaching Marxist revolution. A state leader described the aims of the party and its organ, New Solidarity, as supporting the working class against capitalism. Nelson Rockefeller and Leonard Woodcock, head of the United Auto Workers. The USLP predicted collapse of the monetary system by November 1976 and thermonuclear war by 1977. It opposed the Rockefeller family and had a reputation for harassing the Communist Party, the United Auto Workers, and other political foes. In a 1974 interview, the USLP candidate for governor of Michigan characterized the Watergate scandal as a deliberate attempt to discredit Richard Nixon and weaken the presidency. By 1977, the party had shifted from left-wing to right-wing politics. History. 1972-1976. The U.S. Labor Party was noted for its controversial campaign tactics, and its invective against other politicians. Nelson Rockefeller, the former governor of New York, who was nominated to be vice president by Gerald Ford in 1974, was an early target of the USLP's attention during the Senate's confirmation hearings. LaRouche appeared on behalf of the USLP as a witness against Rockefeller's nomination. He testified that a USLP survey showed 90% of U.S. workers and the unemployed hated Rockefeller. In 1974, the Wisconsin branch of the Labor Party took out a newspaper advertisement announcing that it had filed for an injunction to prevent the CIA, FBI, and the New York Police Department from arresting Lyndon LaRouche, then known as Lynn Marcus, or anyone involved in the movement's kidnapping of Christopher White, who had married LaRouche's former common-law wife. According to detailed descriptions by LaRouche, White had been brainwashed by the CIA and KGB to kill him. The advertisement further reported that the movement had found a cure for psychosis and encouraged mental health professionals to contact them to develop this discovery. USLP member Harley Schlanger, a candidate for the House of Representatives, sued the Mecklenburg County, North Carolina, ABC Liquor Board in August 1976, for prohibiting campaigning on their property, which he contended was public property. The North Carolina ACLU joined the suit. The district court judge decided that the activity was protected free speech that could not be prohibited so long as activists did not block doorways. One of the U.S. Labor Party's strategies focused on disrupting other left-wing groups, with questionable success. William Chapman wrote in the Washington Post in September 1976 that several public figures on the left had reported threats and intimidation, and said those responsible had identified themselves as members of LaRouche's NCLC or U.S. Labor Party. The linguist and political activist Noam Chomsky was accused of working for the CIA and being a tool of the Rockefellers. Meetings he addressed were disrupted, and threats were made. The philosopher Paul Kurtz, editor of The Humanist, was asked during his lectures at the State University of New York why he was practicing genocide. According to Chapman, sociologists Richard Cloward and Francis Fox Piven, specialists on urban poverty, were followed around the country having their speaking tours disrupted. Environmentalist Lester Brown was accused of genocide and told he would be hanged from a lamppost. LaRouche was asked how he expected a party with a five-year record of harassment and threats to win the election. He did not deny the incidents, but replied, "We are only engaged in an open political attack. We just want to challenge them in debate." He denied, however, that anyone had been threatened with physical harm. "Sure, we're going to get them, but politically, The U.S. Labor Party was well-financed, operating from the top floor of a building in New York's Garment District. A teletype network connected the New York office to branches in a further 13 U.S. cities, and also included a two-way, 24-hour link to Wiesbaden. Germany membership was small, ranging from 20 to 100 people per city, with a core of 1,000 to 1,800 members. According to LaRouche, these were complemented by another 13,000 part-time party organizers. LaRouche said the party was funded by members' dues, other small contributions, and the sale of publications like The Campaigner and New Solidarity, one a theoretical journal, the other a twice-weekly newspaper. The party fielded candidates in local and congressional elections, generally garnering only insignificant percentages of the popular vote, but there were exceptions. In Seattle, a Labor Party member running for the city council won 27% of the vote, with another candidate who ran for city treasurer garnering 20%. Presidential campaign in an appearance on Meet the Press with other minor party candidates in October 1976, LaRouche predicted monetary collapse followed by thermonuclear war before summer if Jimmy Carter were elected. LaRouche also described Carter as a nitwit to begin with, an empty slop jar into which bad lemonade is being poured. However, conservative Republicans like President Ford fared better, incongruously so, given the Labor Party's stated left-wing stance. "I call them honest Americans," LaRouche said. He described Ford as "weak but well-meaning" and "a known quantity we can live with." On November 1, the eve of the election, the USLP purchased a half-hour block of time on NBC, the first of many national broadcasts by LaRouche that would follow in election years to come. The time was purchased over the objection of the network, which unsuccessfully appealed the last-minute purchase to the Federal Election Commission during the broadcast, which ran opposite a similar advertisement from Carter on another network. LaRouche said that Carter would have the U.S. irreversibly committed to nuclear war by no later than November of 1977. If elected, according to LaRouche's autobiography, he blew the policy of James R. Schlesinger, for an early nuclear confrontation with Moscow, and exposed the genocidal policies which key Carter backers, such as George Ball, had publicly demanded as measures for drastic population reduction of nations such as Mexico. More broadly, I presented a policy of international monetary reform, as alternative to a deepening crisis in the developing sector. NBC reported receiving hundreds of calls protesting the broadcast. LaRouche's name was on the ballot in 23 states plus the District of Columbia. On November 2, 1976, he received 40,043 votes, 0.05%. U.S. Labor Party candidates sometimes received unusually high vote totals in comparison with those garnered by other small ideologically based parties following the election. The USLP brought lawsuits in three states challenging Carter's victory. The Republican Party joined the suits in Ohio, and New York regional coordinator Paul Greenberg sought a recount in Milwaukee, saying, "The election has actually been stolen. The actual winner was probably Jerry Ford." For more information on LaRouche's 1976 presidential campaign and the movement's legal disputes with the FEC, see Lyndon LaRouche. U.S. presidential campaigns 1977-1982. In August 1977, the USLP said that the Federal Election Commission FEC was intentionally harassing the group as a result of a determination that forgiven debts were the equivalent of campaign contributions. The same month, the USLP hired a former OSS and CIA operative, mercenary, firearms engineer and arms dealer, Colonel Mitch Werbel, to protect LaRouche. They said that LaRouche, then living in Wiesbaden, Germany, was being targeted for assassination by the Bader-Meinhof gang, allegedly on behalf of the Carter administration. Werbel in turn recruited the chief of police from his town, Powder Springs, Georgia, to set up the security in 1978. LaRouche began a vigorous USLP campaign for the presidency in 1980, targeting farmers, small businessmen, and Teamsters Union members in the Heartland states. In May 1978, USLP steering committee member Elliot Eisenberg campaigned in a Chicago suburb, saying that "the reason we picked Schaumburg is because it's a relatively conservative area. There's more of a tendency for people to support nuclear power." The USLP vice presidential candidate, Khushro Gandhi, campaigned in June 1979 and predicted victory based on support from the Teamsters. A faction of the union had ties to LaRouche, running on a pro-nuclear power platform. Gandhi said that the recent Three Mile Island accident was ordered by Energy Secretary James R. Schlesinger in order to create a false energy crisis. By late summer of 1979, the NCLC and LaRouche had decided to join the Democratic Party so that LaRouche could run for that party's presidential nomination, and the U.S. Labor Party was disbanded in 1982. The USLP was sued for $15 million in damages by U.S. News. An alleged CIA contact, who did not exist, Frankhauser, was convicted in 1975 of conspiring to sell half a ton of dynamite in connection with a school bus bombing that left one man dead, and had marched on Fifth Avenue in New York wearing a Gestapo uniform. LaRouche had organized his defense campaign regarding the dynamite charges. Frankhauser asserted he was working for the government and was sentenced to 5 years of probation instead of the decades in prison he could have received. Frankhauser warned LaRouche in 1977 that, according to his claimed CIA contact, Mr. Ed, he was being considered for assassination, and introduced him to Mitchell Werbel III, a noted Office of Strategic Services OSS and Central Intelligence Agency CIA operative, mercenary, operator of a counterterrorism school, accused drug trafficker, firearms engineer, and arms dealer who said he had an ongoing connection to the CIA. LaRouche developed close ties with Werbel, hiring him as a security consultant for protection against the assumed assassination threat and to train his security staff. It was Werbel who arranged for LaRouche movement members to undergo anti-terrorist training. John George and Laird Wilcox say Werbel learned that the way to keep LaRouche on the hook was to feed his monstrous ego while jerking his paranoia chain. Frankhauser cultivated a contact with a media source in New York, enabling him to tip off LaRouche about upcoming stories before they became public in 1979. Frankhauser was also placed on the payroll as a security consultant, having convinced LaRouche that he was actively connected to U.S. intelligence agencies. A government official later said that Frankhauser was one of the few people who could call LaRouche directly. Forrest Lee Fick, an associate of Frankhauser from the KKK, was added as a consultant in 1982. Fick helped Frankhauser, who was not a competent writer, to compose the memos from Mr. Ed. They appeared so authentic that when news about them began to leak out via defectors from LaRouche's security organization, journalists began to speculate about the identity of Mr. Ed. Frankhauser and Fick later testified that, to justify their $700 per week paychecks, they had invented their connections to the CIA, written memos purporting to be from CIA agents, and warned of imaginary assassination plots against the LaRouche's. George and Wilcox called Frankhauser's deception one of the biggest hoaxes in the annals of political extremism, made possible by what they called LaRouche's obsession with conspiracy theories and intelligence gathering. The U.S. LP also had brief contact with the Liberty Lobby led by Willis Carto. Carto had some exploratory talks with LaRouche about a joint strategy against the IRS, but the contact was marked by much mutual suspicion. Carto was troubled by the number of Jews in the U.S. Labor Party, and by their adherence to basic socialist positions, including their support for central banking, while Labor Party members considered people in the Liberty Lobby rednecks and idiots. Criticism. In 1979, a two-part article by Howard Bloom and Paul L. Montgomery appeared in the New York Times that accused LaRouche of running a cult. Bloom wrote that LaRouche had turned the U.S. Labor Party, with 1,000 members listed in 37 offices in North America, and 26 in Europe and Latin America, into an extreme-right, anti-Semitic organization. Despite the presence of Jewish members, the Times alleged that members had taken courses in how to use knives and rifles, and had produced reports for South Africa on anti-apartheid groups in the United States. A farm in upstate New York was allegedly being used for guerrilla training, attended by LaRouche members from Germany and Mexico. Several members also underwent a 6-day anti-terrorist training course, at a cost of $200 per person per day, at a camp in Powder Springs, Georgia, run by Werbel. The Times reported that U.S. Labor Party members were playing a dominant role in a number of companies in Manhattan. Computron Technologies Corporation, which included Mobil Oil and Citibank among its clients, World Composition Services, which the Times wrote had one of the most advanced typesetting complexes in the city and had the Ford Foundation among its clients, and PMR Associates, a printing shop that produced the party's publications and some high school newspapers. See below. Bloom wrote that, from 1976 onwards, party members were transmitting intelligence reports on Left-wing members to the FBI and local police in 1977, he wrote, commercial reports on U.S. anti-apartheid groups were prepared by LaRouche members for the South African government, student dissidents were reported to the Shah of Iran's SAVAK secret police, and the anti-nuclear movement was investigated on behalf of power companies. He also wrote that LaRouche was telling his membership several times a year that he was being targeted for assassination, including by the Queen, big-time Zionist mobsters, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Justice Department, and the Mossad. LaRouche denied the newspaper's charges, and said he had filed a $100 million libel suit. His press secretary said the series was intended to set up a credible climate for an assassination hit. The USLP has also been called a radical and cult-like group. Milton Coppolis of the Heritage Foundation described the USLP as a virulently anti-Semitic outgrowth of the Students for a Democratic Society SDS, which used the Fusion Energy Foundation as a front to win the confidence of unsuspecting businessmen. Washington Post columnist Richard Cohen wrote that the USLP began on the political left but has since gone so far in the opposite direction that to call it politically right is to slander the entire conservative movement. Labor union journalist Victor Riesel, while writing of anti-capitalistic movements, ranging all the way from the Communist Party USA to the Trotskyite Socialist Workers' Party, said in 1976, the most extreme activists in this sprawling radicalism are the youthful U.S. Labor Party. Civil rights activist Julian Bond called the party a group of left-wing fascists. LaRouche critic and biographer Dennis King says that when the USLP sponsored LaRouche's 1976 campaign, the NCLC was still in transition from a far-left to far-right ideology, but by 1977-1978 both organizations, which were really one and the same for all essential purposes, were advocating extreme right positions. King described a typical post-transition USLP campaign in Lyndon LaRouche and the New American Fascism Doubleday, 1989. In Baltimore, USLP candidate Deborah Freeman appealed openly to racist and anti-Semitic sentiments in her 1978 campaign against incumbent Congressman Perrin Mitchell. Chairman of the Black Congressional Caucus Freeman, who is white, described Mitchell as a house nigger for Baltimore's Zionists and an example of bestiality in politics. She won more than 11% of the vote, doing especially well in several white precincts. The NCLC had used similar language as early as 1974, when an alderman in Madison, Wisconsin, was called a house nigger at a city council meeting. According to Dennis King, the USLP chairman advocated launching ABC atomic, biological and chemical warfare against the Soviet Union, as well as the military crushing of Britain, which his newspaper described as the headquarters of the Zionist British organism National Democratic Policy Committee. The National Democratic Policy Committee (NDPC), a political action committee, is regarded as the successor to the USLP. LaRouche's politics were not shared by many in the Democratic Party, allowing him to occupy a niche with little competition. In 1986, the NDPC was reported to have fielded candidates in 146 congressional races, 14 Senate contests, 7 governor's contests and more than 600 state legislative and party posts. USLP candidates Nicholas F. Benton gathered petitions in 1978 for governor of California, but did not appear on the ballot. Michael Billington, candidate in 1977 for county executive of Westchester County, New York, in 1978 for New York's 24th congressional district. Robert Bowen, candidate in 1975 for New Jersey's 34th legislative district, in 1976 for New Jersey's 1st congressional district, in 1978 for U.S. Senate from New Jersey. Elijah C. Zeke Boyd, candidate in 1974 and 1976 for U.S. Senate from New York, in 1977 for Mayor of New York City. Anton Chaykin, candidate in 1973 for Mayor of New York City, in 1974 for Governor of New York, in 1978 for Pennsylvania's 2nd Congressional District. Wayne Evans, candidate in 1975 for Lieutenant Governor of Michigan, in 1976 for Vice President of the United States. Paul Gallagher, candidate in 1977 for 1977 New York City Council President, in 1978 for New York's 18th Congressional District, in 1978 for Governor of New York. Khushro Gandhi, candidate in 1974 for Michigan House of Representatives 18th District, in 1977 for Mayor of Buffalo, New York, in 1978 for New York's 37th Congressional District. Elliot Greenspan, candidate in 1975 for New Jersey's 13th Legislature. legislative district, in 1976 for New Jersey's 4th congressional district, in 1978 for New Jersey's 7th congressional district. Mel Klenetsky, candidate in 1978 for governor of Illinois, candidate in 1981 for mayor of New York City. H. Graham Lowry, candidate in 1976 for U.S. Senate from Massachusetts, in 1978 for Massachusetts's 11th congressional district. J. Philip Rubenstein, candidate in 1978 for lieutenant governor of New York. Harley Schlanger, candidate in 1976 for North Carolina's 9th congressional district. William Wirtz, candidate in 1976 for U.S. Senate from Washington. NDPC candidates and personnel. This list includes those who have been identified as holding a position within the NDPC and candidates who have run in two or more races, won primaries, or have otherwise gained attention while running. NDPC candidates or otherwise identified as LaRouche Democrats. Ted Andromidis, candidate in 1983 for Los Angeles City Council, in 1990 for California's 29th Congressional District, in 1994 for U.S. Senate from California. Mark Calney, Northwest Coordinator for the NDPC, candidate in 1983 for Seattle City Council, in 1984 for Governor of Washington, 1985 for Mayor of Seattle, Washington, in 1990 for Governor of California, in 1992 for California's 30th Congressional District, in 1994 for Governor of California. James J. Cleary, candidate in 1984 for New Jersey's 8th Congressional District, in 1986 for New Jersey's 7th Congressional District, in 1990 for New Jersey's 12th Congressional District, in 1994 for New Jersey's 7th Congressional District with the LaRouche Was Right Party. Michael DeMarco, candidate in 1983 for New Jersey's 7th Legislative District, in 1984 for New Jersey's 13th Congressional District, in 1992 for New Jersey's 4th Congressional District with LaRouche's Democrats for Economic Recovery Party. Mark Fairchild, candidate in 1986 for Lieutenant Governor of Illinois, won the Democratic primary, in 1990 for Governor of Illinois. William Ferguson, candidate in 1983 for School Committee in Boston, Massachusetts, in 1994 for U.S. Senate from Massachusetts with the LaRouche Was Right Party, in 2001 for Massachusetts's 9th Congressional District. Lawrence Freeman, candidate in 1994 and in 1998 for Governor of Maryland. Kushro Gandhi, West Coast Coordinator of NDPC, candidate in 1983 for Los Angeles City Council, in 1989 for Mayor of Los Angeles, in 1989 for California. Lieutenant Governor Bill G. Goff, candidate in 1986 for Michigan State Senate. One Democratic Party primary. Paul Goldstein, Chief of Security. James A. Green, candidate in 1986 for Michigan State Senate. One Democratic Party primary. Elliot Greenspan, Executive Director of the NDPC, candidate in 1983 for New Jersey's 38th Legislative District, in 1984 for U.S. Senate from New Jersey, in 1985 for Governor of New Jersey, candidate in 1986 for New Jersey's 9th Congressional District, in 2001 for Governor of New Jersey. Janice Hart, candidate in 1986 for Secretary of State of Illinois, won the Democratic primary, in 1988 for Clerk of Circuit Court for Cook County, Illinois. Warren Hammerman, NDPC Chairman. Art Hoffman, candidate in 1984 for California's 39th Congressional District, in 1986 for California's 40th Congressional District. Initial results showed that Hoffman won the Democratic Party primary, but a recount gave the victory to a write-in candidate, in 1989 for a seat on the Santa Ana Unified School District Board of Trustees, in 1990 for California's 38th Congressional District. He also ran for the Orange Unified School District Board and the Rancho Santiago College Board of Trustees. In unknown years. Georgia Irie, candidate in 1984 for California's 45th Congressional District, in 1986 for U.S. Senate from Indiana. Sheila Jones, Midwest Director for the NDPC, candidate in 1986 for U.S. Senate from Illinois, in 1987 for Mayor of Chicago, in 1988 for Cook County Recorder of Deeds, in 1989 for Mayor of Chicago, in 1990 for Lieutenant Governor of Illinois, in 1991 for Mayor of Chicago, in 1994 for Governor of Illinois, in 1995 for Mayor of Chicago. Mel Klenetsky, Co-Director of Political Operations for the NDPC, National Campaign Director for LaRouche, candidate in 1982 for U.S. Senate from New York. Brian Lance, Founding Member and Northern California Director of the NDPC, candidate in 1986 for U.S. Senate from California, in 1987 for California's 5th Congressional District. Evelyn Lance, member of PANIC, candidate in 1983 for California's 5th Congressional District, in 1986 for California's 9th Congressional District, in 1994 for U.S. Senate from Texas and for State Democratic Party Chair, in 1998 for U.S. Senate from Texas. Mel Logan, candidate in 2000 for U.S. Senate from Wyoming, won the Democratic Party primary. Rose Marie Love, candidate in 1986 for Mayor of Chicago, in 1992 for Illinois' 7th Congressional District with LaRouche's Economic Recovery Party, in 1994 for Secretary of State of Illinois. Fernando Oliver, candidate in 1986 for Lieutenant Governor of New York, later removed from ballot by court order. J. Philip Rubenstein, President of Caucus Distributors, Northeast Regional Director of the NDPC, candidate in 1985 for Mayor of New York, in 1986 for Governor of New York, later removed from ballot by court order. Dana Scanlon, spokeswoman for NDPC. Harley Schlanger, Southwest Coordinator of NDPC, candidate in 1984 for U.S. Senate for Texas, in 1986 for Texas's 8th Congressional District, in 1990 for U.S. Senate for Texas. Don Scott, candidate in 1984 for Ohio's 7th Congressional District, in 1986 for U.S. Senate from Ohio, in 1990 for Ohio's 7th Congressional District. Louis DuPont Smith, candidate in 1988 for New Hampshire's 2nd Congressional District, in 1990 for Pennsylvania's 5th Congressional District, in 1994 for Minnesota Attorney General, in 1998 for New Jersey's 4th Congressional District. Nancy Spanhouse, candidate in 1990 for U.S. Senate from Virginia, in 1993 for Governor of Virginia, in 1994 for U.S. Senate from Virginia, in 1996 for U.S. Senate from Virginia, in 2002 for U.S. Senate from Virginia. Webster Tarpley, candidate in 1986 for U.S. Senate from New York, later removed from ballot by court order. Philip Valenti, candidate in 1992 for U.S. Senate from Pennsylvania, in 1994 for Pennsylvania. Governor William Wirtz, candidate in 1982 for U.S. Senate from California, in 1983 for Los Angeles City Council. See also views of Lyndon LaRouche and the LaRouche Movement. References. Carrot ABCD. U.S. Labor Party 1973, National Party Conventions, 1831-1976, Congressional Quarterly, 1979, p. 197. Carrot A. B. Reich, Kenneth. September 21, 1977. Tiny U.S. Labor Party Seeks Allies on the Right. Los Angeles Times, page A3. Carrot Kenny, Charles. February 17, 1980. Fringe Candidate or a Threat. The Lyndon LaRouche Campaign. Boston Globe, p. Carrot. Labor Party sues ABC Board. High Point Enterprise. August 24, 1976, p. Carrot. Haislet, Charles. August 5, 1977. Small Town Police Fall into International Mystery. The News. Port Arthur, Texas, p. Carrot. George. Carrot. Cohen, Richard. December 20, 1979. Let Him Run for President with His Own Bucks. Daily Herald. Arlington Heights. Arlington Heights, Illinois, p. Morelius. The San Diego Union. San Diego, Califf, June 1, 1986, PGB 3. Carrot. Labor Party Candidate Seeks GOP Aid. Richard Berghuls, Los Angeles Times, March 14, 1978, PGC 2. Carrot. Candidate, Michael O'Mara. Billington, Our Campaigns. The 28th of July 2009. Retrieved the 18th of April 2011. The 18th of April 2011. The 18th of April 2011. Primary. Narvaez, Alfonso. A New York Times. New York, New York, May 29, 1984, PGA 17. Carrot AB, Rodino beats back opposition. Philadelphia Daily News. Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, June 4, 1986, PG 3. Carrot. The 1990 elections, Bradley wins New Jersey primary. The New York Times, June 7, 1990. Carrot. Statistics of the congressional election of November 8, 1994. Kirkhouska. Retrieved the 18th of April 2011. Carrot. A low-key, high-stakes school board race. Irene Sedge. Globe. Staff. Boston Globe. Pre-1997. Full-text. Boston, Mass., October 31, 1983. PG 1. Carrot. Political line. Nontraditional parties on ballot. Providence Journal. Providence, Rhode Island, September 2, 1994. PGB 01. Carrot. Lynch handily wins Dem nod in 9th. David R. Guarino. Boston Herald. Boston, Mass., September 12, 2001. PG 034. Carrot. gubernatorial candidates discuss minority set-asides and jobs. Cheshire, Mr. Afro, American Red Star, Washington, D.C., August 20, 1994. PGB 9. Roberti blasts political hate groups, cites LaRouche in arguing against publicly funded campaigns. Leo C. Valinsky, Los Angeles Times, pre-1997. Full text, Los Angeles, Califf, April 15, 1986. PG 3. Around the Southland, Steve Harvey, Los Angeles Times, April 19, 1983, PGC 1. Los Angeles Mayor Race, April 1, 1989, Our Campaigns Retrieved 18 April 2011. Allies Suffer Setbacks News, Sun Sentinel Wire Services, Sun Sentinel Fort Lauderdale, August 9, 1986. PG 6A Carat, LaRouche aide arrested by FBI in credit scam, Seattle Times, November 6, 1986. A 5 Carat, Mary M. O. C. H. A. R. Y. as GOP victor in Jersey voting, Alfonso and Narvaez NYT, The New York Times, June 6, 1984. Section B, page 5, column 6 Carat, Bradley has been running hard, hoping not just to win but win big. Dale Mezzacapa, Philadelphia Inquirer, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, May 27, 1984. PGV 5 Carat, gubernatorial rivals assail Shapiro. Andrew Maycuth, also contributing to this article, were staff writers Doreen Carvajal, Lounsbury, et al., Philadelphia Inquirer, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, June 1, 1985. PGB 1 Carat, Schundler wins GOP primary in New Jersey governor's race. David M. Halbfinger, New York Times, New York, New York, June 27, 2001. PGA 1 Carat, LaRouche wants magnetic trains, Hart urges tax on futures trading. Larry Coase, Chicago Sun, Times Chicago, IL, January 1, 1987. P 36 Carat, AB Bush wins, Simon and Jackson 1 2 Paczynski rolls over Byrne, 4 of Sawyer's allies lose ward races, big vote margin stuns ex-mayor John Camper and Robert Davis. Cheryl Duvall, Gene Davidson, John Cass and Jerry Thornton. Contributed to this report, Chicago Tribune, Chicago, IL, March 16, 1988. PG 1 Carat, Democrats now take LaRouche seriously. William Osborne, The San Diego Union, San Diego, Califf, March 23, 1986. PGA 1 Carat, ABC, Santa Ana Unified, 7 candidates vie for 2 seats. Chris Efticiu, The Register, Orange County Register, Santa Ana, Califf, November 2, 1989. PGO 5 Carat, LaRouche candidates hooted at Convention of County Democrats. Lainey Jones, Los Angeles Times, Los Angeles, Califf, March 23, 1986. PG 1 Carat, California's vote count deadline is later than Florida's. Martin WISCKOL, Orange County Register, Santa Ana, Califf, November 14, 2000. PG Page Carat, Democratic nominee won't contest Dornan. Dave Lesher, Los Angeles Times, pre-1997. Full text, Los Angeles, Califf, June 9, 1990. PG 12 Carat, Hunter's politics is key vote issue. Don Davis, The San Diego Union, San Diego, Califf, October 24, 1984. PGB 1 Carat, AB, few LaRouche followers win in 4 primaries. Paul Houston, Los Angeles Times, Los Angeles, Califf, May 8, 1986. PG 21 Carat, business is unusual for LaRouches. Thomas Hardy, political writer, Chicago Tribune, pre-1997. Full text, Chicago, IL, March 14, 1988. PG 5. Carat, for U.S. Senate, Ranney, Chicago Tribune, Chicago, IL, February 16, 1986. PG 2 Carat, 2D wave of opponents hits Mayor R. Bruce Dold and Mitchell Lawson, Chicago Tribune, pre-1997. Full text, Chicago, IL, February 26, 1987. PG 1 Carat, in every political race, there are stragglers. Robert Davis, Chicago Tribune, pre-1997. Full text, Chicago, IL, February 10, 1989. PG 5 Carat, LaRouche's face ballot bumping over petitions. Fran Spielman, Chicago Sun, Times Chicago, IL, January 24, 1990. PG 1 Carat, Daley confirmed as victor in Chicago party primary. Associated Press, Boston Globe, Boston, Mass., February 28, 1991. Carat, position unknown, LaRouche leader puts lid on interviews. Dennis Conrad of the Associated Press St. Louis Post, Dispatch Pre-1997 Full-Text St. Louis, Mo., February 17, 1994 PG01-. Like father, like son. Piling up big victories in mayoral races is a tradition for the dailies. Thomas Hardy, Chicago Tribune, Chicago, Ill., March 5, 1995 PG1-. Democrats scrutinize LaRouche Bloc, Robin Toner, New York Times, New York, New York, March 30, 1986 PGA 22. Carrot, CBS sells time to fringe candidate for talk. Kerr, Peter, New York Times, New York, New York, January 22, 1984 PGA 23. Carrot, notes on people, Klenetsky to seek Moynihan's job, Albin Krebs and Robert MCG Thomas Jr. New York Times, New York, New York, January 28, 1982 PGB 13. Carrot, the congressional race, the candidate's views on seven major issues, San Francisco Chronicle, San Francisco, Califf, April 1, 1987 PGA 2. Carat, LaRouche backers bid for House, Spurs dismay in California, Judith Cummings, special to the New York Times, New York Times, New York, New York, April 6, 1986 PGA 26. Carat, 14 meet filing deadline for SF House race, Jerry Roberts, San Francisco Chronicle, Pre-1997 Full Text San Francisco, Califf, February 24, 1987 PG 2. Carat, doctor supports Prop 64 sort of, Charles Petit, science correspondent, San Francisco Chronicle, Pre-1997 Full Text San Francisco, Califf, September 30, 1986 PG 8. Carat, Lawrence Kessenbaum, Index to Politicians, Lanigan to Larkham, The Political Graveyard, retrieved 18 April 2011. 1. Carat, woman challenges Slagle as Dem chief, Houston Chronicle, Pre-1997 Full Text Houston, Tex, April 19, 1994 PG 20. Carat, UN inspectors see construction work at Saddam's palace, Vijay Joshi, Austin American Statesman, Austin, Tex, March 30, 1998 PGA 6. Carat, IR Volume 27 Number 34, September 1, 2000 LaRochePubCom, 1 September 2000 retrieved 18 April 2011. New York Times, New York, New York, August 13, 1985 PGB 4. Carat, LaRouche follower declares candidacy to oppose Cuomo, The Associated Press, New York Times Late Edition, East Coast, New York, New York, March 25, 1986 PGB 3. Carat, Mexican party said funded by LaRouche, Arthur Golden, The San Diego Union, San Diego, Califf, June 1, 1986 PGA 1. Carat, LaRouche candidate quits race. The Associated Press, Sun Sentinel, Fort Lauderdale, May 10, 1986 PG 9A. Carat, campaign 86, Houston Chronicle, the 4th of February 1986 Carat, our campaigns, candidate, Harley Schlanger. Carat, LaRouche indulges in explosive rhetoric, Don Davis, The San Diego Union, San Diego, Califf, June 3, 1984 PGA 1. Carat, candidates ducking of debate called dumb move. The Plain Dealer, Cleveland, Ohio, March 21, 1990 Carat, top posts are up for grabs in NH Sununu's decision to eschew new term causes reshuffling of candidate field, John Elamon and John Milne, Globe staff, Boston Globe, Boston, Mass., June 12, 1988 PG 36. Carat, few gains for LaRouche candidates politics, the leader of the group has lowered his sights, he is waging a jailhouse campaign for Congress, William M. Welch. Los Angeles Times, Pre-1997 Full Text Los Angeles, Califf, July 29, 1990 PG 22. Carat, when DuPont air short circuits, Skip Humphrey better watch out, Doug Groh, staff writer, Star Tribune, Minneapolis, Min., August 14, 1994 PG 03B. Carat, few tough primary races expected across the state, excitement is limited, the area's congressmen have no foes for nomination, Tom Turcall, Philadelphia Inquirer, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, June 2, 1998 PGB 1. Carat, our campaigns, candidate, Nancy B. Spanaus. Carat, Freund comes from behind on Arlen John M. Baer, Philadelphia Daily News, February 19, 1992 PG 16. Carat, LaRouche troops campaign against Humphrey, Bob von Sternberg, staff writer, Star Tribune, Minneapolis, Min., February 7, 1994 PG 01A. Carat, our campaigns, candidate, William F. Wirtz, VE LaRouche Movement History, Lyndon LaRouche, Views of Lyndon LaRouche. LaRouche Criminal Trials Lyndon LaRouche U.S. Presidential Campaigns Organizations Bürgerrechtsbewegung Solidaritat Citizens Electoral Council European Workers Party Executive Intelligence Review LaRouche Movement National Caucus of Labor Committees Schiller Institute Worldwide LaRouche Youth Movement Defunct California Proposition 64 1986 Fusion Energy Foundation North American Labor Party Party for the Commonwealth of Canada U.S. Labor Party Members Robert Beltran James Bevel Michael Billington Amelia Boynton Robinson Norbert Brainin Anton Chaikin Jacques Kemenade Billy Davis Sergei Glaziev Janice Hart Hulin Jack Kenneth Kronberg Stanislav Menshikov Theo Mitchell Robert James Moon Kesha Rogers Natalia Vitrinko William Warfield